Welcome to our next video in the series on condensed matter theory. In this video, I want to talk about bound states that can occur at the surface of a crystal. And these bound states can disperse in the direction perpendicular to the surface, but not propagate into the crystal. So as such, they will make perfectly two-dimensional electron gases at the surface of a crystal. And the reason for these bound states that I want to discuss in this video is an additional potential that we can add or might find at the surface of our crystal. In the next video, I will discuss surface bound states that happen without an additional surface potential. But for now, we're going to have a simple reason why we have a bound state. If you think of the potential as a function of distance, then at the surface you will find a step edge such that electrons can form states that are localized inside the crystal but don't propagate out. So this is our surface. Now, close to the surface, the last atom has a bond to the left but not to the right, and that might lead to a change in the distance or the positions of your atoms. You might even find that you get an additional monolayer of a different chemical compound on top. You can get hydrogen termination, for example, and that can give rise to a change in the potential close to the surface, such that the potential is lower, and where here your wave functions are plane waves, what you find here is that, of course, there is the plane wave, but there might be an additional bound state at the surface. Now, I do not want to discuss this in terms of a basis of plane waves, but we want to look at a tight binding Hamiltonian. So in a tight binding Hamiltonian, we can change the hopping and on-site energy of the states in the final layers. And I'm going to make a simple model where I will just change the hopping or the on-site energy of the last final layer and show you the effects that this can give rise to, and then of course qualitatively we'll be able to explain the different phenomena, and quantitatively you have to put in the right parameters for the material that you look at. So our tight binding Hamiltonian is given by a sum over crystal momentum in the x and the y direction, z is 1 to infinite in the z direction. Then our on-site energy, which is momentum dependent in the x and the y direction. Plus our hopping in the z direction. And this is the Hamiltonian without an additional surface potential. A minimum model for that surface potential is to say that we have a change in the potential for the last layer, or the first layer, the layer with z equal to 1. And there we're going to change the on-site energy epsilon kx ky to epsilon prime kx ky. And then we have to subtract the energy that we gave here, such that we can just sum the two Hamiltonians to get the one that we have for the full system with a modified surface potential. Now, in order to solve this, there are a few different ways that you can calculate your Green's functions and your local Green's functions. You can build it up with a continuous fraction method, which is, of course, nice and very intuitive. A link here again. But when you build this up with a continuous fraction method, or there, because I'm small, then it's not so easy to answer the question, do I get a bound state or not? Actually, when you use the Dyson equation, another link to the video up there, then we have a very nice way to determine if you get a surface bound state or not, because you can relate the poles of the disturbed system to the poles of the undisturbed system. So let's use the Dyson equation. And our Hamiltonian and our Green's function we'll call H0, so G refers to the system without a surface potential, and H prime and G prime are gonna refer to H0 plus H1. And in order to make my notation a bit shorter, I'm gonna suppress the kx and ky indices. They are there in the Green's functions, I'm just not gonna write them down. So with the use of the Dyson equations, we can relate the Green's function of the system with the additional potential to the Green's function without the additional potential. And the propagation from z prime to z is given by the bare propagator plus the bare propagator from z to side one, or actually I'm reading in the other direction, and the scattering epsilon prime kx ky minus epsilon kx ky, and then the propagation with the full propagator from z prime to 1. So the propagation from z prime to 1 with the full propagator is given by the propagation where you do not scatter from z prime to z, or you move from z prime to 1, you scatter and you move from 1 to z. Now of course here that equation still depends on itself, but now you can put the Dyson equation back in again. That will give you a geometrical series that we can sum up to infinite order. And the result is that your Green's function is the bare Green's function plus Gs z1 omega epsilon prime kx ky minus epsilon kx ky Gs 1 z prime omega divided by 1 minus, and that comes from the summation of the geometrical series, and the local Green's function, because when you scatter more than once, you have to propagate from side one to side one. Now the poles that we have with an additional surface potential are equal to the poles that we have without a surface potential. So these are the states that have the same eigenenergies as we have in the bulk, and they can propagate straight into your system. We can, however, get an additional pole if the denominator here becomes zero, such that this diverges. So we find a bound state if Gs, and now let's put in the momenta again, kx, ky, z is 1, kx, ky, z is 1 of omega is equal to 1 over the impurity potential with respect to the bare potential. So when this is true, we will find an additional bound state. Now, in order to test if that equation is fulfilled or not, we can have a look at our local Green's function of a semi-infinite chain. And for a model of an S-band, we can have a look at both the imaginary and real part. Real part of our Green's function. The imaginary part is a semicircle, and the real part is a linear behavior and a decay on both sides as a function of omega. Centered around the onset energy and a width of 2 SS sigma on each side. Now we can also have a look at one over epsilon kx ky prime minus epsilon kx ky, and we can distinguish two cases. If kx of is the potential is small, 1 over becomes large and there is no solution. If the potential is larger, then there is a solution where they are equivalent. And of course, in this point, the real part is equivalent, but the imaginary part of the two functions is not. So only here you will find an additional bound state. So in this case, we have no bound state. And here we have one additional bound state. So if we look at the imaginary part of your local Green's function for different values of the surface potential, as a function of frequency, then here we have the case where epsilon kx ky minus epsilon kx ky is 0. If it is small, we find no additional bound states, so we have the same energies for our densities of states, but might get a shift in spectral weight. And for the case where it is large, you will get this additional bound state, and then the spectral weight in the continuum again. Now this is the result for a single crystal momentum in the x and the y direction. If we look at our surface band structure, surface brilouin zone, gamma x bar, m bar, gamma bar. Then we have our dispersion, cosine-like, and cosine-like for kz is 0 and kz is pi over a. And in the case that we have this strong surface potential, we get an additional bound state. And the plot that I made here is for the case where epsilon prime kx ky minus epsilon kx ky is a constant. When it's a constant, we get an equal binding energy for that bound state. Now, if I create a particle in this state, then this is a function that exponentially decays into your crystal, but mainly lives at the surface and can propagate in two dimensions. If you look at MOSFET devices, for example, then it's exactly these kind of states where these particles live, and these are truly two-dimensional devices, at least at low temperature, two-dimensional electron gases. We can define a Hamiltonian for those particles, and that is the surface Hamiltonian. And we have now truly just a two-dimensional system where we have our on-site energy, and let's call this the on-site energy of the surface particle. It is, well, the bound state energy, we have calculated those, but for now it's not so important what its value is. We just know that it sits somewhere there, inside an Ernie window where there are no other states. And then we have the dispersion in the x and y direction. And creation and annihilation as a function of kx and ky. Perfectly two-dimensional particles moving on the surface. Now, when we have a surface, then of course the local potential can be different, so the on-site energy can be different, but actually also the hoppings could be different. So if we look at our surface, then the interaction here is what we call SS sigma, but the interaction here could be different, SS sigma prime. If we take that into account, then epsilon kx ky prime minus epsilon kx ky, so the change of potential at the surface, or H1, is going to be epsilon s prime minus epsilon s, just the difference in on-site potential, which result we have plotted here, plus 2 ss sigma prime minus ss sigma times cosine kxa plus cosine kya. So there is now also a change in the hopping, and this is the hopping in the xy direction, so we Fourier transform and diagonalize the Hamiltonian in that sense. Now let's have a look at an example. And we're going to take epsilon s prime minus epsilon s is minus 2 as a sigma. Sure. I want to use, I was a bit confused, so this is not related to the hopping. I'm just going to take that on-site potential in units of the hopping, because then you know you have one energy unit in there. So this is just the shift in constant potential. Then we have our change in hopping parameters. 2SS sigma prime minus SS sigma is going to be equal to minus SS sigma. And SS sigma is just our energy unit in this case, such that I have one energy unit in my system. If you do this, then epsilon kx ky prime minus epsilon kx ky is equal to minus 2 minus cos kx a minus cosine ky a times SS sigma. So at gamma bar, we find that the on-site energy difference for the topmost layer is minus 4 SS sigma. At X bar, it is minus 2 SS sigma. And at M bar, it is 0. And somewhere halfway between them, it is going to be minus 1 SS sigma. And when the on-site potential is bigger than SS sigma, we have a bound state. But when it is smaller than SS sigma, we have no bound state. So if we now look at our surface band structure, gamma bar, X bar, M bar, gamma bar, cosine-like dispersion, a cosine-like dispersion first in the X then in the Y direction, then a cosine-like dispersion in the X and the Y direction simultaneously, either for kz is 0 or kz is pi, then we have, first of all, the eigenvalues that you also have in the bulk. Now we have our bound state for the range from gamma to X, whereas at gamma you have a larger binding energy than at X, and somewhere in between X and M, that state is going to disappear into the continuum, and let's make that state in a different color. And once it becomes degenerate with the continuum, it becomes broadened, and then at some point it appears again. And there the dispersion continues. Now, the first thing that one can have a look at is the energy momentum dispersion of the surface states. So let's have a look at epsilon s kx ky. And now for the cases where it's a resonant or where it's an bound state, it's very easy to find what the eigenenergy is. You can just read it off. Here it's no longer completely clear. But if you look at your Green's function, then the real part of your Green's function for a single resonance, it goes up and it comes down. If you have a finite broadening, it will be zero at the resonance. So if we look at the real part of kx, ky, z is zero. At the energy of our bound state. Of course, we don't know this one yet, but this is going to be zero. So that gives you an equation that you can solve to find the energy momentum dispersion of our bound state. If you do that, then you find that you get a nice dispersion until you hit the continuum, and then it's flat, and then when you come out of the continuum, you disperse again. Now, besides an energy momentum dispersion, you also have a width. Of course, when it is in bound state, the width is zero. That's a pure delta function. But once you're degenerate with a continuum, you have an imaginary part in there. So we can have a look at the self-energy of your particle as a function of kx and ky. And if you just do not look at the energy dependence, but only at the value at the resonance, then this is just given by the Green's function. Well, actually, this is the surface Green's function with the impurity potential evaluated at, and this is S kx, ky, at the energy of the particle where your real part is zero. And of course, there's a minus one in there. So this is zero as long as you have a bound state. And the moment you hit the continuum, this is no longer zero and changes. And the broader the peak becomes, the deeper you're inside the bands. Now, the model that we made here for surface state is not an artificial model in the sense that most surface states that we have are bound states for some range in k values, but then become degenerate with a continuum for some other k values. The fact that we did this for a single S-band with on-site potentials, you need quite large on-site potentials to make this happen. So for such kind of systems, I don't think for a single S-band you will find this realized in nature. But the idea that a surface band is a bound state for only some region in your relevant zone actually is more rule than exception. Now, if you now make a Wernier function for the bound state, that's something that you can definitely do, and then you define a Hamiltonian for that bound state, then you run into a problem. Because the energy momentum dispersion is not analytical. It has these kinks. So if you truly want those kinks in your energy momentum dispersion, you will need infinitely long range hoppings. But even worse, the self-energy is zero in a large part of the Hilbert space, but then all of a sudden it starts to become non-zero in another part of your Hilbert space. And that is a real problem, because that is just a non-analytical self-energy. Well, you can solve the fact that you have kinks in your band structure by adding some dispersion to the final state and putting that back into a self-energy, such that you can define short-range tight-binding Hamiltonians. The way you do that is when you create your Wernier functions, you only integrate over the part where you have a bound state, and then the rest will just follow in some way, and you can always modify that back with the self-energy. But the imaginary part of the self-energy is really a problem, and it is truly non-analytical. Now, why is this such a big deal? If you remember, we did, when you do Dyson equations, you are getting a geometrical series, and then you sum this to infinite order, and you get then this 1 over 1 minus x out of that. Now, summing a geometrical series to infinite order is only valid when you converge. And when you have a bound state, your geometrical series is outside its range of convergence. Then we argued that you can still use this because our functions are analytical. So we can evaluate this sum for a range where your series converges, and then analytical continue outside that range. But now our functions are no longer analytical. So that entire construct that we built there is becoming problematic. There are materials where experimentally people observe non-analytical Fermi surfaces, Fermi arcs, where basically the band structure starts at some point and ends at another point. Now, if this is truly a non-analytical Fermi surface, or if it's just very hard to observe the other part because of folding in your bands or spectral weights that become very small, is highly disputed, especially because our numerical methods, our theoretical methods, have a very hard time to still work when Green's functions become non-analytical. So if it truly would be true that these systems have non-analytical Green's functions, cooperates, so Fermi arcs, the high-temperature superconductors, then theory is in a big problem. But, well, nature is not always nice to us. And this is a very simple model that shows you that you definitely can create non-analytical Green's functions. So, yes, we have a very nice model. It works very often. But it's not going to be the end of all the theory that we have developed. Thank you very much for your attention. We'll see each other in the next video or in the lecture. Stay healthy.